telling us about how the prisoners were being transported on a train towards Terezin.
Then we got stuck on this train station, and many of my fellow prisoners died. It was raining, so as it was difficult to sit on the floor of the wagons full of water, so we said our poor dead fellow prisoners who didn't mind at that point. At that point they let us bury some of our dead comrades. And there was a fight between the SS and the railway employees who insisted that they will give us their ration, their food. And that was the first time after 2 days when we got some food. Water wasn't bad, for it was raining, but the food, that was tough. So we got something, and we have seen the tracks, the trains with the wounded German soldiers trekking back towards Germany. And we were stuck for 2 days standing there, and suddenly, on the night between 8th and 9th of May, we didn't realize that this 7th and 8th of May, sorry, that the war came to an end. They hitched an engine to us and they dragged us to something called Litomyrzhice, Litomyrzice, which was we were stopped there on a train station, and from there it was still blackout. Everything was in the darkness, and in the distance we have seen a lit huge space, a city. We knew it's Terezin. Terezin was lit, something very unusual, and we got the order to get out of the wagons. No yelling, no beating, and the whip was a short guy who was standing on a box and was telling us that if we marched orderly, that it's night, and if we drag on the small wagons, which we'll get all our dead comrades, and if we help anybody who can't walk, that we will march in front of Terezin and they will transfer us to the International Red Cross. We didn't capish so quickly. But we have seen one thing. We have seen this lit Terezin, we have seen that we are being handled a little bit differently, and then Rakoska, the whip, says, and remember that whatever we ever did was an order, we never did anything of our own initiative, and should you be ever asked, you will answer that way. And we started to march. And as we were, we really marched. Yeah, we came to the river Elbe, which is one of the main rivers then ending in Hamburg. And as we were crossing it, then both sides were Russian soldiers. They were Ukrainian soldiers of the Vlasov's army. VLASOV was a general who turned against the Russians and was fighting on side of the Germans, and at that point they were turning against the Germans, but they let us, and the SS men walked through, and we walked about another couple of kilometers, and then they ordered stop, and they came into formation by three, and they turned around and marched away. And as we jumped into the ditches which were on the side of the road, and we were lying there expecting that they will spray us with the machine guns, and nothing like that ever happened. And then, I mean, after a few minutes, we have seen two buses coming close, and they were empty, they were fully lit, on where one was written Czech Red Cross, and on the other was written Croix Rouge Internationale. And the drivers came out and says, no, my God, you look, but try to walk into Terezin, for if we take you, you will have to stay in the quarantine camp, and that may take you a few weeks to be free. Try to walk. So we walked.
How did you look, Dr. Roden?
We couldn't couldn't get it, you know, what is happening, that it happened.
What did they see? What did the drivers of the Red Cross see?
They have seen this haggard. They are accustomed for, we were probably not the only ones who came, I mean, there on trains and similar. They were gathering their prisoners already for a few days. They had already a quarantine camp, and that was really, the International Red Cross was in Terezin. And so we marched, and then we came to this barrier, and that was the casino which I mentioned, with the gendarmes, and there is the gendarme standing at the kind of this thing, this barrier, the rod which is put across the road, and he says to us in German, halt, and in German, sit down and wait. And my friend, George Wasserman, we are sitting there quite stunned, realizing that there is no SS, there is only the gendarmes. And we look at the building, and on the building there are two flags hanging, and there is lit, so it's a bad lighting, but still light. And I see a white flag with a red cross, and next to it is a white, red, with a blue triangle, a flag of former Czechoslovakia, which was, I mean, it was automatic arrest and automatic concentration camp to show it. And I look at the gendarme and on his hard cap, on his hood, he has got a little tricolor with the Czechoslovak flag. And I go to him and I say, in Czech, what's the meaning of this? And he says, Christ, you speak Czech? He says, using a bad word, we all speak Czech. We all came from this town 2 years ago simply, and we are just returning. He says, oh, Mother of God, and runs into the casino, and they put the floodlight on us, and out runs an officer, I mean, who is just closing his uniform, and steps on the barrier, and he says the first word is, he says, brethren, using an ancient word for brothers, I welcome you back as the citizens of free Czechoslovakia. And we have been 195 at that point, and 15 of us could walk. The rest, they had to help to the gathering station, for they simply collapsed. They were out. Most of them, I mean, we have been over 200, about 5 died still in Terezin of exhaustion. And a little funny vignette, as we were walking with George Wasserman through the street towards the place where they send us, this is also small military barracks, he says, there you get food and everything. So we walk through the street and he says, here in this house lived my mother. She was a famous Czech couturier, haute couturier, dressmaker, per prima. He says, ah, it's naturally somewhere in the Auschwitz oven. I said, don't be silly, let's try. We walk in. There is the room where she was supposed to live. There is light on, and there is a lady, old lady, probably younger than I am now, bent over reading Mrs. Wasserman. And we make a little noise, so she turns around. She looks, and says, George, it's really you? Was the only son. It's really you. Look how you look so dirty. Go and wash. It was her first reaction. But we continue, for we had to go there. Anyhow, we got food and we got washed. And the nurses simply were absolutely berserk to see this, and they did absolutely everything. They fed us with risotto, rice with a little bit of veal in it, and we drank milk, and we were put on straw mats, which were covered by white sheets, white cloth, white pillow. And he said, just sleep the night through. And I woke up George. It was about 5 in the morning, and we realized we are hungry. He said to to the nurse, "What about some food?" He says, "Come, I'll take you into the kitchen." So the cook did some eggs for us. He says, "Don't put any fat on it, nothing. I mean, the guys cannot stand it, but anyhow, we got bread and eggs." And there appeared a guy on the scene. He says, "The bus, our bus for Prague, we'll be leaving in about, we are leaving in about half an hour." And we could hear tremendous noise. The Russians were pulling towards Prague, which was already free, but they were liberating Prague. And he said, "We are going with you." He says, "We are going with you." He says, "Sure, but you need some documents." So there was either the military commander of this, who made some kind of documents written, but put the necessary stamps on it, that our name is so-and-so, and we have been liberated that and that day from this and that camp. And with that, we entered the bus. It was early in the morning. The Russians simply, we had a Russian inscription, and then Czechian inscription, that the martyrs of Terezin are welcoming you, Prague. Somebody made these two banners, and they let us through. While the German, they were dragging the German prisoners up, so they, between the tanks and between the army, we simply wheeled our way. We got to the city of Melnik, where we were welcomed. We were, obviously, somebody must have had some connection. We were welcomed there by a welcoming committee. They were throwing us cigarettes and bread and everything. And for the first time, the last time probably in the history of the Czech folk, they were yelling, "Long live the Jews, Nazdar, hi." And so we went to Prague, and suddenly the bus was going through a city where the streetcars were running. And at one point, the bus driver said, "Whoever lives here, or close here, so we can step out, otherwise we are going to our final destination is..." Actually, it was the medical, the complex of the Czech College of Physicians and Surgeons. And that's where I was thrown out in Prague. And we entered a streetcar. We didn't have the tickets. The conductor found out that we have got numbers on the thing. He stopped the streetcar. People were giving us money, giving us addresses, giving us cigarettes, getting hugs. And we got to George's apartment, which was empty, and we are free.
When did you actually realize that the war had ended? At what point did you...
When the men told us, "You are citizens of free Czechoslovakia."
At that moment when you were liberated?
Uh-huh.
How long did it take you to find Eva?
I went the same day. I went to this address where I found her letter. These were her cousins, of second-round cousins. And I knew that she is in Hamburg. She was in Hamburg at that point in time. So first I went there. I found out that there is a special kind of department of citizenship, which gathers the lists of liberated prisoners from all over Europe, whether there is anything from Hamburg, which it wasn't. She wasn't. There was a list from Hamburg, but she was not on the list. Then I got myself an apartment according to the wishes which we had with Eva, that we will look for something, like my office is upstairs. One big room, a modern bathroom in a modern building with elevator, with modern kitchen, and with everything. And I got it allotted from the Czech authorities. It was seized from some Germans.
Did you return to your home address?
No, I didn't run. I returned, but somebody was living there, and it would be very difficult to dislodge them, so they gave me a replacement apartment. And they gave them a replacement apartment to my mother when she returned. And I was going to this address, simply looking for Eva regularly every day, and about 10 days later, I found out that there are two guys there who are saying that they are going to Hamburg to bring the list of the liberated prisoners plus one very kind of prominent Czech writer who was liberated in Kiel, K-I-E-L, in a camp. And so I said, I'm going with you. She says, hold it, we need an interpreter. I said, you just found one. Yeah, and I proclaimed myself for an interpreter. They slept over in my place, and then we entered a truck, which was a Chevrolet 1922, which did not make the mountains quite, but we got to the Russians, and we got it repaired, and we simply got ourselves to the vicinity of the Belsen, where I knew that 300 of our guys landed in Belsen, and with the help of a Swiss officer, we got into the camp, which was out of limits, for there was really typhoid and everything. We didn't know that we are not in Belsen, that Belsen was burned, but that we are in Bergen, which were SS military, SS Lazaret, hospital barracks, and everybody was located there. And there was a, we still have got time, there was a liaison officer, Czech liaison officer. I found out there were little squares and there was a Czech flag. I went to the liaison officer who was living there in Toronto here for quite a while. And he gave me the lists of the liberated prisoners. There were dozens of names which I knew, but Eva wasn't on it. And meanwhile, one of the girls spotted me, so I was surrounded by dozens and dozens of kids who were hanging on me and were asking my husband, my brother, my beloved one, God knows what. I said, kids, my memory is limited. Please, let's sit down and ask one after the other. I will try. And if I knew that the person is alive, so it was a great jubilation. If I knew that the person died, I kept it for myself. And after about 15, 20 minutes, somebody says, did you see Eva at all? I said, Eva? She's alive. Out that she's in a hospital, that she survived typhoid and typhus. She had a combination of both, and that she's working there as an interpreter, that she's weak, but she certainly will be able to see me. And one of her friends, Ruth, who lives in Israel and who was her best friend and who became a great journalist and was a great friend of ours, who was kind of her twins during the experiences in the camp. So she ran for her, and she told her, hurry, we have made an arrangement when there is a possibility to go back to Prague. So you simply, we had to register. So she escaped from the hospital under the wire, barbed wire, and as she was running, so the kids were yelling at her, congratulations. She didn't capish, didn't understand what's going on. And then the door opens, and she sees me. Whereupon she faints flat. And as we are trying to revive her, so she asks about her father, who meanwhile returned, so she faints again. And simply that's how I found her. She dieted quite well, for she, her weight was 37 kilo. And I had to go with the guys anyhow to Kiel. And on the way back, we picked up Eva plus some friends, and we drove with a huge seized German car, which the two guys stole there from a military depot, and every military police stopped us, but on the numbers they let us go. And we returned to Prague. It was beginning of June 1945.
When did you and Eva come to live in Canada?
We left Czechoslovakia on the 30th of November 1948 when it became communist. It became communist in the spring. We got ourselves legally out. We waited for the Canadian visa in Switzerland, and we came. We landed in Fort Erie on the 6th of March 1949.
Can you tell me a little bit about your family today?
Today, we've got three children. I start with the oldest, Dan, who is married, who's got three children. Our oldest is 19. He's at the university, the second year. Then there is one 17, Paul, who was here last week visiting with us. And then we have got Claire, who is 12 years old.
These are your grandchildren.
Grandchildren. Then I have a son, Peter, who lives in Boston. Danny lives in Nashville. And Peter lives in Boston, and he's got one child, Daniela. And then our youngest, Michelle, calls herself Misha, M-I-S-H-A. And she's got two children. One of them is Noah, who is, Daniela is 5+, and Noah is 4+, and little Sasha, who will be 2 years old. They all are healthy, and I hope that they will have the patience to listen to me.
Are they aware that you are doing this taping today?
Yes, actually one of my grandsons, Paul, was the instigator of this.
How did he do that?
He wrote to the Holocaust Museum, and then he registered me with the Spielberg Foundation.
Dr. Roden, in a very few words, can you summarize for us your career, which has been quite illustrious in Canada?
Yeah. I was 3 months short finishing medicine in Prague. I left, for we know that we will be arrested. And in Switzerland, I could have continued, but I had a visa to Canada. We had transit through the States. I could have stayed probably in the States, but we went to Canada, and I tried to get back into medicine. It took me 2.5 years. I had 189 negative responses for, at that point, the veterans were entering medical schools. And meanwhile, I started to study at the Université de Montréal, where I got from them a master's degree. They recognized my bachelor on account of the 13 grades, and a master's degree in Slavic literature. And that enabled me then to get to Queens a little bit, but I got to Queens, to medical school, by a fluke. And I finished medicine. I was in great debt, so I decided after 2 years of residency to go into general practice so that I pay my debt back. And meanwhile, I, 4 years later, got my mother into Canada, who came in and had her first stroke in the plane. And she stayed in the hospital for enormous quantity of time, and all the finances were drained, so I stayed in general practice. I became very, very successful at that point. And just out of curiosity, I wanted to continue to study, so in 1965, after taking many courses, some of them together with Eva, I get a PhD in literature from l'Université de Montréal. I continued with my practice. In 1969, I decided that it's the highest time I switched to something else. I took training in psychoanalysis and additional training in psychiatric training. And in 1975, I get qualified, and I start doing solely psychotherapy, with a certain exception for all my friends who came with me went with me in camp, they did not recognize that I am doing psychiatry, and for them I am still simply a practitioner, which is quite good. That's how I came to Canada.
If you had the opportunity to leave a message for your grandchildren and great-grandchildren who will see this tape, and for all the others, what is the message you would want to give them, Dr. Roden?
It's a scout's motive, probably. Be prepared. I believe simply that maybe humanity learned something, but in very small doses. You know, the cruelty of man to man has no end, and the kind of division between people is being kept artificially by so many means and ways that they have to have their eyes and ears open and be well trained and well prepared, and I hope that they inherited some, maybe, of the intuitiveness I might have inherited from my forefathers.
I want to thank you for honoring us with your memories today.
Thank you.
What we are looking at in this picture?
We are looking at the picture which I found in the Auschwitz Eins, number one museum in the Czech block. It's taken approximately in May 1944. It's on the ramp of Birkenau Auschwitz. It's an oncoming or incoming Hungarian transport, and we were sent to bring some medical supplies from the train. The commando is walking directly through the prisoners in front of the SS men, which as well might be Mengele. I don't remember. But I am there on the picture in the, from looking for me from the left corner, it is being circled. That's all what I remember about it. I don't remember being taken for the picture. Must have been taken by an SS man.
Tell you the story.
Okay.
This picture was taken by an unknown British soldier on the 16th of April 1945. It shows an unconscious young woman stricken by typhoid, lying there forlorn. We found it in Belsen Museum as a blow-up, and it's Eva, who was found there. There is an arrow in about the middle of that photograph. That's a room in which Eva stayed in Theresien before she was transported to Auschwitz. This is in Theresienstadt, in the walls of the fortress. where we had to chisel out a window to comply with the regulations, and we were four guys living in it before my transportation, before actually I moved somewhere else while being in Theresienstadt. This is the registry index card, which is at the Jewish community in Prague. And there is, on the right side will be the translation of it in English, stating simply that I left for Theresien on the 24th of 10th in 1942 by the transport by the name of CA number 740 and left Theresien for Auschwitz with the transport which is mentioned there. And in the right corner up is mentioned that I reported back to the registry, meaning I returned. This is a picture from one of the walls of Pinkas Synagogue in Prague, where the bare white walls bear the names of nearly 90,000 Czech Moravian Jews who died in the concentration camps during the Hitler's period. The mortality, general mortality, was about 88% of all the population of the people of Jewish origin living in these countries. There in the middle one could see the name of Berthold, born 13586. That's my father. Next to him is actually my uncle and my aunt. This is a map of the camp in Schwarzheide, which shows the barracks on the left side and the trench I mentioned, and then on top there is a gas, small gas chamber prepared for us, which was never used. There the German then show it on a memorial, which I'll show on the next picture. And then on the right side there is a route of our march up to Prague, which we marched up to the point where it's written Warnsdorf, and from there we went with the train to Theresien. This is a memorial plaque which is in the place called Schwarzheide, which was built by the Germans in memoriam of the people who stayed there as prisoners and who died there. This is another memorial plaque from the same place, recognizing the death march from Schwarzheide to Theresienstadt, which started on 18/4/1945. This is another memorial plaque on which translation says that on this place was standing the gas chamber of the site camp Schwarzheide, 1944-45, which luckily was not used due to the fact that the war was rapidly coming to an end. These shoes are part of the memorabilia which we keep in one special little suitcase. These are the shoes in which I marched from Schwarzheide and was liberated then and came to Prague.
How many kilometers did you walk in those shoes?
I must have walked in it for quite a while, naturally, in the camp, but then it was over 350 kilometers. This is from the Index Lexiconum, meaning the roster of the lectures which had to be stamped for each semester and started to study medicine in Prague. I used to be younger. A promotion of the book we wrote with Eva together about our war experiences. This is from the University of Texas Journal, and we are at that point signing and trying to promote the book. It's a very rainy day, and we are in 1988, standing on the space of B2B camp in Auschwitz-Birkenau. There were only remnants of the chimneys around us and the remnants of the barbed wire in the background, and there is the memorial and the dismantled remnants of the dismantled gas chambers and crematoria. It's a family picture on the anniversary of the 50 years wedding. So it's old, about 3 years. There is one grandchild missing, which we'll fill in later pictures. This is the picture of my oldest son and his family. It's about a couple of years old, but they all look at it quite well, or on it quite well.
Okay.
This is my middle son, Peter, and the granddaughter, Daniela. That is my youngest, Misha, and her family. Husband Scott, Noah, and Sasha. This is Eva and I in Schwarzheide, which the city keeps as a memorial sacred grounds, for it burned down the camp.
When was this picture taken, Dr. Roden?
The picture was taken 2 years ago, actually last year, when I tried to retrace our death march. Every year I celebrate my birthday with a party in our country place in Eastern Townships, and these are the surviving co-prisoners.
Can you please tell us who you see in the picture?
One of them is Fred Korn, George Ehrman, Joe Wesley, I, Charlie Ehrman, and Frank Horsky. They all are very, very good friends of mine.